Is the clicker available?
Sabrina, Carissa, Javier, thank you so much. And to our worship team for leading us today with those wonderful selections of music, and everyone that helps us make our services come together. Thank you so much. Appreciate that you're willing to serve your church and make the service wonderful. Thank you, Eric. All right. Thank you so much. Let's pray. God in heaven, we dedicate this time to you. We ask that it would be your word heard in this place, your name would be uplifted, and that you would be worshipped and praised, and everything that happens here would be according to your plan and bring you praise and glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I had just a little congestion this morning when I woke up, so if I sound a little bit more like Garth Brooks, that's why. So, holy, holy, holy. It is quite a thing to be talking about today. I would love to remind our regular folks and any of you who are new that one of the things I've always done in my sermons when I begin is I like to have a short interactive time with the kids. So I do a kids quiz. And I like to have the kids participate here in the beginning. And if Toby and George maybe, let's see, is Black and which one? Yellow? Robin? Are those who work? This way it can get recorded when for those that are watching on home from home or watching on YouTube, and also makes it so people can hear it. So just a simple question, what are some of the holy things in the Bible? Let's have some of the young people remind us. You know, there's all kinds of things here. All right, Andre. Is the yellow one working? Try again, Andre. The Ark of the Covenant. That's right, going right to the source, or you know, right to the primary thing, the Ark of the Covenant. Thank you. Awesome. Other holy things in the Bible. Okay, I see some back here, George, or over here. All right, is that Dylan? And it's nice to be able to hear it when it's said.
Holy Spirit?
The Holy Spirit! Yeah! That's not very hard. Okay, and then over here, Abel?
The cross.
The cross, the Holy Cross? Well, it's certainly a holy event and a very sacred thing. Over here?
The Ten Commandments.
All right, the law, the holy law. And I see, they're so excited, they're standing, George.
The angels.
The holy angels. And then Lindell?
And God's throne.
His throne, his holy throne, sure. Ketzia? The temple? Yeah, absolutely, the temple. All right, Toby, can you come to Isaiah right here? He is going to instruct us in the things that are holy. Okay, God, yeah, sure. You were going to say that, weren't you? Stole your thunder. All right, right over here, George. I see another hand. Holy things in the Bible.
Bible?
The scriptures themselves, sure. We call it the Holy Bible, don't we?
Yes, we do.
All right, over here. Oh, is it Julian? Yeah.
The ground in front of the burning bush.
The burning bush? The holy ground. Yeah, excellent. All right, just a couple more here, Andre. The church, the holy church, all right.
The Sabbath.
The Sabbath? All right, one more. If there's anyone, or are we basically done? All right, last one down here, over here. George, can you see him? He had one earlier.
The Garden of Eden.
Garden of Eden. Well, there's certainly some holy aspects of it. I don't know if I see that specifically. All right, thank you, George, Toby. Thank you to all of you participants for helping us remind us about those things in the Bible that are holy. You know, none of the kids said marriage. Isn't that interesting? You know, we call it holy matrimony. Well, none of the young people thought of marriage. It's kind of a joke. Now, there's more in the Bible than just here, but all three persons of the Godhead are called holy. Of course, we talked about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Father, and Jesus, even when he was in the womb, was called holy. So they are all holy. Of course, God's word is holy. His name, separate from his being, even his name is holy. And we think about how we use the name of God and how important the name of God is. That is set aside as something in the Bible as holy. The temple and everything associated with the temple, the priests, the sacrifices, the furniture, the utensils used for the drink offerings and the plates and pitchers and cups and everything, the ground that the temple on was holy. Everything associated with the temple was holy, and that was very important. The tithe. The tithe is called holy. No one said that. We always sometimes forget. The tithe is holy. The law was mentioned, the Ten Commandments and the law in general. The Sabbath especially, even though the Sabbath is part of the law, there is special emphasis in the Bible about the holy nature of the Sabbath. When I was getting ready for this sermon and just reading about what other people said about what's holy in the Bible, I came across something from Max Lucado that I want to share. Now, I want to just share with you, I love Max Lucado. If you don't know who he is, he's a Christian author and does good things for children's ministry, and he's a very reflective writer. And I really admire Max Lucado, okay? So I just want to say that. He's not a Seventh-day Adventist, but he gives a list of what is holy, and he mentions the Sabbath. And of course, as an Adventist, I'm always interested when non-Sabbatarian Christians talk about the Sabbath. And so I just wanted to read this to you. This is Max Lucado. Let 6 days be used for work and acquisition, but set aside one day, okay, for spiritual and physical restoration. And then he quotes from Exodus, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And then he says this, under the Old Covenant, under the older covenant, this day was Saturday. As Christians, we set aside Sunday, which is what a lot of Sunday church-going folks say. We set aside Sunday, though many Christians still observe a Saturday. The day of observance matters less than the message of the observance. God wants us to worship and to rest. Now, to some degree, I agree with that. The spirit of the law of the Sabbath is important, isn't it? And we lose, if we're only focused on the letter of the law, and we lose the spirit of the law, well, then we're not really keeping the Sabbath either. But God wants us to worship and to rest. Then he says this, he designates the first day of every week as holy. He does the same with the first dime of every dollar. Now, I read that fast, okay? But what's interesting to me is in one paragraph, he has now stated three different realities about the Sabbath. One, he says it's just one day that's set aside. Then he says, under the Old Covenant, it was Saturday. And he says, as Christians, we set aside Sunday. But then he says, he designates the first day of every week. Okay? Now, I'm not just here to pick on Max Lucado. I'm not here to pick on those who say that. But this is a classic example of cognitive dissonance, where you can literally believe two irreconcilable things at the same time. In the same sentence, he says, we have set aside the first day. And then he says, he designated the first day. And again, we would just differ with that. He closes, after he lists all these things of that are holy, this is how he sums it up. The width of home plate is not up for discussion. Neither is God's call to holiness. So again, just in my little Adventist antennas, I go up and say, you've just said the word of God is unquestionable. You've just said we're not allowed to change what God has said. But yet when it came to the Sabbath, he's made a different decision. And again, that is not uncommon. I just found that very interesting when I hear other Christians talk about what we view as God's revealed word when it comes to the seventh day of the week being his Sabbath, and he is consistent in Scripture like that. But the Sabbath is designated as a special day and being holy unto God. The church is called holy. Family, including marriage, sex itself is called holy in the Bible. And children, your children are called holy. Did you know that? I know they don't always act holy. We sometimes think of them as holy terrors. But they are called holy in the Bible, and there are a lot of other Bible verses. Interestingly, the church is called holy. Israel is called holy. So as a group, we are called indicatively or intrinsically holy, but yet as an individual, we are not called holy. We are called to be holy. We are called to be holy. And you understand there's a difference between that. Everything else on this list is intrinsically holy. The temple, yes, you can defile the temple, but the temple was holy. It was intrinsically holy. The Sabbath, the church, all these things in and of themselves by God's designation are holy. We are holy when we are following the will of God, but we are called to be holy. So let's just remind ourselves, what does holy mean for a second? I like when I ask this question and people say things like this. What means sacred, blessed, or consecrated? And really all that is a synonym, right? Well, what does it mean to be consecrated or blessed or sacred? Well, it means to be holy. You kind of get into a circular argument here. But we understand these words help us describe what we mean by that. Uncommon, exceptional, special, when we use the term holy. Separate from the normal or ordinary, that's kind of more of a practical use. You know, there's a holy, or there's regular food, right? And then there's holy food that was used in the temple. There's a regular building, and then there's a building that's been dedicated to God, and we call that the church and the sanctuary, and that makes it holy. So the things that are regular, normal, common, that's fine. They have their purpose. But things that have been set aside for God are called holy. They are separate from the normal or ordinary, and they have a reason for that. Holiness is also used in the Bible to separate the creator from the creation. Okay, that which is of God is different than that which God has created. We'll talk about that just a little bit. In essence, and I'm not excellent at rhetoric and things, but probably the most easy layman way of looking at it is that which specifically belongs to God is holy. Okay, if it belongs to God, then it's not to be used for ordinary use. It's not just you can do whatever you want. It belongs to God, therefore it's holy. And there are more ways that we can look at that. So I want to talk a little bit more about this, but as I get into this, I want to share with you another thing that I came across that I think is quite excellent. This is from Charles Spurgeon.
Drew, are you here?
There you are. You may recognize this because it was in one of the books that you brought to the office once. Okay, Charles Spurgeon, a great English preacher, and his sermon called The Immutability of God. Speaking of the New Park Chapel in Southwark, England, he opens up his sermon with these words. Now, I know it's hard to follow along when someone's reading. This is a little bit of a lengthy passage, but I think it's incredibly profound, and I would just encourage you to follow along with the words here spoken 150 years ago by Charles Spurgeon. He says this, quote, "There is something exceedingly improving to the mind in the contemplation of the divinity. It is a subject so vast that all our thoughts are lost in its immensity, so deep that our pride is drowned in its infinity. Other subjects we can compass and grapple with. In them we feel a kind of self-content and go on our way with the thought, behold, I am wise. But when we come to this master science, the science of studying God, we find that our plumb line cannot sound its depth, our eagle eye cannot see its height, and we turn away with the thought that vain man would be wise, but yet he is like the wild colt, and with the solemn exclamation, I am but of yesterday and know nothing. No subject of contemplation will tend more to humble the mind than thoughts of God. No subject of contemplation will tend to more humble the mind than thoughts of God. And we shall be obliged to feel, great God, how infinite art thou, and what worthless worms are we. But while the subject humbles the mind, it also expands it. He who often thinks of God will have a larger mind than the man who simply plods around this narrow globe. The most excellent study for expanding the soul is the science of Christ, and him crucified, and the knowledge of the Godhead and the glorious Trinity. Nothing will so enlarge the intellect, nothing so magnify the soul of man, as a devout, earnest, continued investigation of the great subject of the deity. And whilst humbling and expanding, this subject is also eminently consolatory. Oh, there is in contemplating Christ a balm for every wound. In musing on the Father, there's a quietus for every grief. And in the influence of the Holy Ghost, there is a balsam for every sore. Would you lose your sorrows? Would you drown your cares, then go plunge yourself in the Godhead's deepest sea. Be lost in his immensity, and you shall come forth as from a couch of rest, refreshed and invigorated. I know nothing which can so comfort the soul, so calm the swelling billows of grief and sorrow, so speak peace to the winds of trial, as a devout musing on the subject of the Godhead. It is to that subject that I invite you this morning." Now, I know I read that fast, but he was quite the thinker, he was quite the wordsmith, and I think that what he says there is quite profound. What's even more impressive to me is that he was 20 years old when he wrote that, when he spoke that. 20 years old. God blessed certain individuals with the ability, I think, to share profound thoughts about the things of God, and Spurgeon was one of them, 1855. I want to talk about God this morning, the true knowledge of God, and the whole purpose of the Christian walk that we have, and how Isaiah's experience helps us understand that. But just a true knowledge of God. Sometimes we forget in our Christian experience that all the things that define us as Christians are directing us towards a singular objective, and that is to know God. Okay? Everything that we do as a believing community is designed to draw us closer to an intimate knowledge of God. Notice what Jeremiah says here. Let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, the mighty man of his might. Let not the rich boast of his riches, but let him who boasts boast of this, that he understands and knows me. That's what God cares about. Remember, sin separated us from God, and God has been on this journey from that time until now to restore the distance and destruction that sin has done. The entire journey of Christianity is not just to understand a core set of principles, not just simply to behave a certain way that is holy and good and all that, but all these things are designed to draw us closer into intimate relationship with God. Does that make sense? And all throughout the Bible, this sentiment is repeated. I'm just going to give you a few verses here, but sometimes we forget why we do what we do. It's not just about wisdom and might and riches. I delight in loyalty rather than sacrifice, and in the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Now, God loves our sacrifices and our offerings and our giving and our sharing, but all these things are supposed to be done in the context of how that draws us closer to God. If you bring your offerings to the temple and the lamb is slaughtered, and you're not thinking about that provision is on your behalf and that God, that is God's gift to you, you miss out on the blessing. When you bring your sacrifices, when you bring your tithe, when you bring your energy, when you give up your time to the church, and you remember that that's because God is using that to bless others and bring power and strength to others, that's fine. But if you're doing it just as a rote behavior because that's what you think you need to do, you're missing out on the whole point of it. Does that make sense? George, am I going too fast? Should I get louder? No. I know these are deep thoughts, and you're all just in solemn contemplation. Yes, it's wonderful. Jesus says in his beautiful prayer and passage in John 17, this is eternal life. This is one of those statements where he just comes right out and says it. This is eternal life, that they may know you. It's to know the Lord. It's to have intimacy with him. It's to have a restored relationship and knowledge of God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, you have sinned. Knowledge of God and to know him. Even here in Daniel, I like this. Daniel 11, that very mysterious chapter that we still argue about in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, all its meanings and twists and turns, but it makes it very clear in a few passages. By smooth words, he will turn to godlessness those who act wickedly toward the covenant, but the people who know their God will display strength and take action. So knowing the Lord is what is going to sustain us in the last days. Now, keeping the Sabbath and following the clear teachings of Scripture are vital, are important. It's part of our intimacy with God. It's part of our faithfulness and obedience. But it also has to do with us having a relationship with Jesus where we know his heart. We know that he loves us. Ministry of healing. A knowledge of God is the foundation of all true education and all true service. So you remove a knowledge of God, what kind of education are you getting? You remove an intimacy and relationship with God, what is the value of your service, and what is the accomplishment of it? All these things are tied together. Transformation of character, purity of life, efficiency in service, adherence to correct principles. Now, those first statements, that describes the Seventh-day Adventist. We were a reform movement when we opened, when we began in the latter part of the 19th century. Reform dress, reform diet, reform theology. We were a reform movement, so transformation of character, purity of life, service, efficiency in service, adherence to correct principles, those are all wonderful things. Those really define to a large degree what kind of the defining boundaries of what we are as a people. But Mrs. White says all of these depend upon a right knowledge of God. You remove or you twist the reality of who God is, and the rest of these things lose their significance and in many ways can become more of a detriment than a blessing. So I want to come then to Isaiah's experience in Isaiah chapter 6 and use this as an illustration of the knowledge of God and the significance of what Isaiah experienced. I know you're familiar with this passage. You can follow along if you want. Most of the verses will be on the screen here. And you remember how it begins. So Isaiah says this, in the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord. Very profound statement. You don't come across this statement very often in Scripture. God is usually not visible. And even when asked to be seen, the followers of God are usually told it doesn't work that way. But in vision, in a special revelation, Isaiah is given the privilege of this visage of God. He says, in the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with the train of his robe filling the temple. I like to give a little context to these passages so that we can get into the mind and the heart of what was going on in at the time of the prophet wrote this. Isaiah is 16 years old when this happens. Did you know that? At most, he was 16. At most. He could have been 14. He could have been 12. But he is a teenager, for sure. He's an adolescent. He is living at an extraordinarily critical time. The Assyrian Empire is on the move. They are on the doorsteps of Judah. And again, I try to put this into, if you were to imagine for a moment, imagine China, which tends to be one of our greatest geopolitical adversaries, at least that's what I hear in the news, right? Let's imagine China declares war on the United States, and we've been at war for 10 years, and it's not going well. Okay? They've already conquered Canada. Sorry, Canada. Already conquered Mexico. Sorry, Mexico. Chinese armies are at our border, either side. They're already encroaching. All their warships are on the coast. Are you with me? Just imagination now. I'm not predicting. I'm not saying. Okay? I'm trying to get you into the mind of what's going on. Israel is besieged by a foreign power that is threatening her very existence. Okay? And the Chinese are saying, we are going to subjugate you. We are going to enslave you. We are going to do terrible things because we are the empire that's going to do that. I'm just an analogy, okay? I'm not anti-Chinese, okay? Just got to be careful. Just an analogy, okay? And let's say our George Washington or our Dwight Eisenhower, whoever our most significant leader who has been rallying the country and has been speaking hope and has been saying, no, no, we're still going to be okay. And we're gonna be able to imagine he dies. That's who Uzziah was. Okay? He was the stability factor of Israel during this time. He was one of the few kings called good. Most of the kings are not called good. You know that? He was one of the few. He had his mistakes and he made some errors. But he was one of those standing up against the power. And so this 16-year-old young man watches as the most prominent defender of faith and the most prominent speaker on behalf of Israel is now dead. Do you see what's going on here? So when God comes to Isaiah, he comes to him at a critical time in history. And he gives him this vision. And what God gives Isaiah becomes a foundation for every believer that would come after them. This vision, not just what he sees, but what he hears. He saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with a train of his robe filling the temple. He sees his God escalated and elevated beyond the things of earth, despite what the foreign powers and the threats and everything else will be going. Seraphim stood above him, each having six wings. Seraphim is a transliteration. It just means burning ones. Of course, it's a reference to some sort of angelic being. I asked in a couple sermons ago, are there any passages in the Bible that mentions angels with wings? The seraphim have wings, and the cherubim have wings. But there's no passages that I've ever found. And the cherubim are angels. Okay, I get that. But the combination of angels and wings can sometimes get a little confusing at times. But this is, that was for free, by the way. That was just a side note. This is a powerful vision of Isaiah seeing these beings. In Revelation, they're called four living creatures surrounding the throne of God. And this powerful, you know, they're covering their faces, they're covering their feet. And they are worshiping the Lord. And I'm not going to get into all the meaning of all this. I want to get to what Isaiah hears. And he hears one call out to another. And this is what they said. Holy, holy. You can hardly contain yourself, don't you? You got to say that third one. Holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The foundations tremble. The voice of him called out when the temple is filled with smoke. Okay. Holy, holy, holy. This is the first and only time in Scripture, in the Old Testament, where the triplicate holy, holy, holy is used. if it had not been for the dramatic way in which God had revealed this to Isaiah, this would have been considered blasphemous. The Hebrews understood that certain things were holy. They had the temple. They had all the things that were holy. They even understood that some things were extraordinarily holy, like the Holy of Holies and the Ark of the Covenant. But to call something three times holy was unheard of and dangerous. As a matter of fact, this is illustrated in the fact that the Dead Sea Scrolls, you know, you've heard before that the Dead Sea Scrolls are like 95% accurate, right? And they're almost an exact match to the Masoretic text, and it's a wonderful thing and all that. And that's all that's true, right? God did an amazing thing by preserving the Dead Sea Scrolls. But of the small percentage of things that are different between the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Masoretic texts is this passage. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's only two holies. The Hebrews were not comfortable with the idea of three holies back to back to back. It had never happened before, and it only happens here in Isaiah chapter 6. Interesting. We're so used to it. We sing about it, and it's in our, you know, our poetry and in our songs, and we treat it as such a normal thing. Holy, 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 as though that was the common thinking, as though that was just the natural expression. It's not. It's extremely rare and limited and has to be carefully analyzed because the Jews themselves, when they come down to the time of Christ, when if it was the Essenes writing it, and as they were copying it, they said, we're comfortable with holy, holy, but I think we're going to leave out that third holy. Now, because Revelation 4 does repeat this with the holy, 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 we accept that the Masoretic text is accurate. There should be three holies there. So what is this all about? Now, I want to just be honest with you. There's more to this than we can cover in the next 10 minutes. But I want to share with you just a couple of, I think, wonderful blessings that God intended to reveal to us when he had this vision to the 16-year-old boy named Isaiah. Why the holy repeat? There's some simple functional reasons behind this. Emphasis, enumeration, and then explanation. The emphasis is the easiest. In ancient literature, if you wanted to emphasize something, you repeated it. They didn't have highlight and bold and shadow and, you know, 3D and blinking lights like we do on our text now. If we want to emphasize something, we can make it bigger. We can do that. In the ancient text, if they wanted to emphasize something, they repeated it. And you see that throughout the Bible. We have four Gospels. The stories of Samuel and Kings are repeated for the most part in Chronicles. Deuteronomy itself means repetition of the law. It's God repeating the important things that have already been shared. Revelation is basically a book of repetition. 75% of Revelation is just quoting and repeating what is already in the Old Testament. It's for emphasis. It's for focus. It's to define and bring precision to the idea. So something being emphasized that God is holy. Well, we know of holy things. That's fine. No, he's holy, holy. Wow. Well, we do know of things that are extraordinarily holy, like the Holy of Holies. He's holy, holy, holy. Oh, that's an emphasis. All right. And that's one of the reasons to emphasize the character and holiness of God. Enumeration is not to be left out either. There were three persons of the Godhead. And even though this isn't widely distinguished in the Old Testament, right after God asks, or Isaiah sees the vision and he hears the angels cry out, holy, 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 God says, whom shall I send? Who shall go for us? He identifies himself as a plurality. And Isaiah would become one of the most forefront of presenters of the reality of three persons of the Godhead throughout the rest of his book. In chapter 7, just one chapter later, he'll talk about Emmanuel as the Redeemer who would come of the Virgin. In Isaiah chapter 9, he would talk about the holiness of the Father. In Isaiah chapter 11, he would emphasize the holiness of the Spirit. So the enumeration that all three members of the Godhead, it's not like the Father is holy, and the Son is, kind of secondarily holy, and the Holy Spirit has a little remnant of holy or something like that. No, each of them embraces that character of holiness. So the enumeration factor there, I think, is appropriate, and many commentators will point to that. But the most probable and I think beneficial way of looking at it is this way of understanding it's a description of the character of God. A description of the character of God. And this can go many different ways, but I'm just going to share with you in brief this way. He is wholly above us. He is wholly above us. Now, that might make God sound distant and, you know, away. Well, if he's above us and he doesn't relate with us, he doesn't know us. In the ancient world, you wanted a God who was above you because most of the pagan gods were just like us. Most of the pagan gods lived and died. They had affairs. They were capricious. They broke their word. They were just like us. They provided no security. They provided no hope. And because they made the gods out of their own image. They made the Egyptian gods. They made the Babylonian gods. They made the Assyrian gods just like they were. Which is the problem with idolatry. The holiness of God says, no, I am above and beyond the things of earth. I am not bound by life and death. I am not bound by the present, past, and future. I exist in all these. I am apart from these things that are not satisfying you. I am wholly above you. I am wholly separate from you. And that's a good thing. Because we need someone who is not bound by our same fickleness and our capriciousness and a God that's simply made in our own image. He is also holy with you, with us. So even though he's above us, he comes down and ministers and lives with us. And this is something I mentioned in Sabbath school, that we need to not just glibly ignore this fact. You know, Mrs. White says in Desire of Ages that Christ was repulsed by sin. That it took a supreme act of effort on his part to draw close to humanity because his nature was so repulsed by sin. You know, we're the opposite. We are attracted to sin. We in the news, they say, if it bleeds, it... Someone knows. If it bleeds, it leads. Right? We love to see destruction. We love to see conflict. We love to see brokenness. If you remember, when there's an accident on the side of the road, you notice that everyone slowed down, not just because the police are there, but they slowed down because they're looking. Oh, yeah, that's going to cost them at their, I hope that's okay over there. We're attracted to it. When you go to a ball game and someone streaks, okay, people don't go like this. They go, oh, yeah, look at that right over here. You get your camera, streaker. Not me, Nick. No. Others do that. We're curious about evil. We're attracted to it. We have a desire to draw close to it. This is different than God. The fact that he draws close to us is part of his supreme divine love, that he comes close to us in our darkest moments. The king of the universe will be wholly with us despite our sins, despite our failing, even though his character is repulsed by that, even though he does not like to see the suffering and the division and the anger and all the things that characterize us. He likes to come close to us and draw us near and take us on better pathways. He is wholly with us. Lastly, his holiness is for us. His holiness is the answer to our sins. His holiness is what brings us redemption. His holiness, only a holy God could do for us what Jesus Christ did. If he was simply as frail and broken and sinful and selfish as the rest of the gods, his sacrifice would not have been sufficient. His holiness brings us redemption. His holiness brings us hope. His holiness heals us. And that's what Isaiah needed when he saw the king, high and exalted, and he heard the call of those burning angels who were covering their faces and covering their feet and flying with their other set of wings and crying out, he is holy! And he is holy! And he is holy! He is everything that you need him to be for your salvation. As, to tie this with what Spurgeon said, knowing God is holy humbles us in a way we need to be humble. Knowing that God is holy expands our minds. It makes us think greater thoughts of him. It makes us appreciate him as being someone worthy of our worship. And knowing God is holy heals our hearts. And it begins us on a journey, a worthwhile journey, of knowing the heart of God, knowing that he is completely, totally holy. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Any endeavor we make in this world and life, devoid from a relationship and a desire to know the character of God and have intimacy with the Father, will leave us wanting. Knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. The psalmist said, who is like the Lord our God? Who is enthroned on high? Notice what he says here. Who humbles himself. God himself humbles himself to behold the things that are in the heavens and in the earth. He raises the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and with princes of the people. The study of God is not a single sermon or a series of lessons. It is a lifelong endeavor. It is something that God invites us to every morning when we wake up and we say our morning prayers or we read our devotional. Every class that we take, everything that we do with our lives is an opportunity to learn more about God. And he wants to be there with us. Are you thankful that God is holy? Are you thankful that he is holy? Holy. Holy. I invite you to study it more for yourself. Read the scriptures yourself and let the Holy Spirit teach you of who God is. Let's pray. Jesus, we love you today. I know this is the tip of the iceberg and is just the beginning of a much grander endeavor. But Father, I pray that you would just give us wisdom, that you would give us joy, and you would give us a passion for knowing you more. We know that you have revealed yourself in the scriptures. You've revealed yourself in nature and in human relationships. And God, it is your supreme desire to restore that separation that has happened because of sin. And by faith, we can see you. By faith, we can hear you. By faith, we want to know you more. We love you, Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen. Thank you for being here. God bless you. If you can stay for the meal afterwards, we'll see you over at potluck. Other than that, happy Sabbath.